You know about the 1JZ, you know about the 2JZ, but do you know about the Toyota inline six turbocharged engine which came before both of them? That engine would be the 7M-GTE, and it laid the groundwork for the JZ series of engines. While it might not get as much attention on the internet as the JZ series, the 7M-GTE is an awesome engine with a lot of potential. Today I'm going to tell you everything you need to know about it. Toyota introduced the M series engine family all the way back in the 1960s, and they made it all the way up until the 1990s. All Toyota M series engines have a few things in common. That is that they're all straight sixes, they all have a cast iron block, and they all use cast aluminum cylinder heads. They all also use overhead cams, although some of the earlier models were single overhead cam, where the 7M GTE is a dual overhead cam engine. By today's standards, those features are not cool, notable, or interesting at all. But in the 60s, 70s, 80s, and even some of the 90s, those were actually relatively advanced features, and it's not something that you saw on every single engine. The breakdown of the engine code is as follows: 7 for the 7th generation engine, M for the engine family, G for performance wide angle dual overhead cam, T for turbocharged, and E for multi-point electronic fuel injection. Because the 7M GTE is part of the M series family, it uses a cast iron block with a cast aluminum cylinder head. Because this was designed as a performance application, Toyota specifically used dual overhead cams to maximize airflow and power potential. What makes the GTE version of the 7M interesting is the fact that it uses a C26 turbocharger that outputs around 6 PSI of boost. This is different than the ordinary 7M GE, which is naturally aspirated. If you're familiar with Toyota's typical naming scheme, this shouldn't come as much of a surprise. The 7M GTE features electronic fuel injection, which was just making its way to cars in the US. We expect this feature to be on any car today, but back then, it was a relatively new technology, and it was great to see it on the 7M GTE, and it really put it above the pack. Naturally, with a cast iron cylinder block, the 7M GTE is a very heavy engine, but that's expected with that kind of material. Now, in terms of internal specifications, we're looking at an 83 mil bore, a 91 mil stroke, 8.4 to 1 compression ratio of 4 valves per cylinder, and pretty much all just standard stuff, really. One interesting thing about the internal specifications is the fact that stroke is larger than bore. This is different than a lot of modern engines that you'll find, which are typically going to be square in the sense that bore and stroke are equal, or even over square, where bore is going to be greater than stroke. But the 7M GTE stroke is longer than bore, which should help it make more low-end torque, which is really great for street use. Unlike other Toyota engines such as the 2AZ, 2GR, or even the 1MZ, the 7M GTE wasn't used in a bunch of different vehicles. The M series was used in many vehicles overall, but the 7M specifically was only used in a couple of vehicles. Now, the 7M is a performance-based engine, and Toyota doesn't make nearly as many performance vehicles as they do with economy vehicles, and this was especially true in the 80s and 90s when the 7M was just hitting the scene. As you can see from the list on the screen, the 7M GTE was really only used in two vehicles. Once again, this is because the 7M GTE was a performance engine, and Toyota didn't really make all that many performance vehicles at the time. Plus, the 7M GTE was pretty quickly replaced by the 1JZ, which we'll talk about a little bit later. Quite a few 1990s Toyota engines are known for excessive oil consumption, and this is typically caused by worn out piston rings, but not always. There's other issues that can cause it. Now, luckily, the 7M GTE doesn't appear to be nearly as bad as other Toyota engines of the time. Specifically, a lot of their four-cylinder engines really struggled with this, but the 7M GTE is really not that bad as far as oil consumption compared to other Toyota engines of the time. The big issue with the 7M GTE comes at the cylinder head, and specifically the cylinder head bolt. Toyota failed to torque the head bolts as tight as they should have been from the factory on many 7M GTEs. Eventually, they discovered this issue, and they changed their assembly process and raised the torque spec for the head bolts, but it still left thousands of 7M GTEs with head bolts that were not tight enough. Now, eventually, this leads to a blown head gasket. And if the engine is old, it can experience many blown head gaskets throughout its lifetime. The simplest fix for this issue is to simply retorque the head bolts to the proper spec. Now, a common upgrade would be ARP head studs rather than head bolts. Another common problem that you'll find with a 7M GTE is Rodnock. And unfortunately, this is just because the 7M GTE isn't built to the extremely high standards that the 1JZ and 2JZ are, which basically just means it's not as strong and as reliable as those later engines. That's not to say that the 7M GTE is an unreliable engine though. because you still have to remember it's a Toyota engine and it's capable of outlasting most other engines that you'll find in road cars today. To put it simply, the 7M-GTE was one of the least reliable Toyota engines produced in the 80s and 90s, but that still makes it a very reliable engine overall. Now, this is where we come to the part of the video where the 7M-GTE is it's not exactly ideal compared to the JZ engine family. What I mean by this is that the 1JZ and the 2JZ, they're super legendary. Everybody knows that they can handle a ton of power on a stock bottom end. They're very easy to modify and they're very easy to make a lot of power with. The 7M-GTE, while it is a good engine and can make a lot of power, it's not nearly as good as the 1J or the 2J. Now, don't get me wrong, the 7M-GTE is a strong engine with a lot of potential, but compared to the 1JZ-GTE, which came right after it, it simply isn't as strong or as reliable, which is why many Mark III super owners just eventually swapped to the 1JZ-GTE to get the most performance possible from their car. Even better than both the 1JZ and the 7M-GTE is the 2JZ, but that's a discussion for a different time. Compared to other engines of the time, the 7M-GTE was insanely tough, but Toyota managed to outdo themselves with the JZ series. That doesn't make the 7M-GTE bad, it just makes the JZ engines better, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. Thanks to the 7M-GTE laying the groundwork for the JZ series, those engines ended up being much better, thanks to the development and the experience that Toyota gained with the 7M-GTE. Of course, it's hard to argue that the 7M-GTE is in any way better than the 1JZ or the 2JZ, because factually, it's not. But there is one area that the 7M-GTE is arguably better than both JZ engines, and that's with affordability. This is because swapping to a JZ engine is becoming increasingly expensive as quality JZ engines become harder and harder to find and more popular for swapping into other platforms such as the 240SX. The 1J and the 2J have a very strong cult following, as you probably know, and if you want to get your hands on one, you're probably gonna have to fight with some JDM fanboys that are willing to pay the insane price just so they can sit at the meet and talk about how great their JZ is. On the other hand, the affordable 7M-GTE can be found laying around your local junkyard for a fraction of the price of a JZ while still giving you 80% of the power potential of a JZ. This makes the 7M-GTE potentially better when it comes to potential output per dollar spent. You have to remember that the 1JZ, the 2JZ, and the 7M-GTE are not the only awesome Toyota engines that you can put into your performance car. You have to remember about engines like the 1UZ, the 3UZ, the 2GR, the 1MZ, the 1ZZ, the list goes on. There's a lot of other great options out there. Moving on to the block and the bottom end, the 7M-GTE does have a strong block and bottom end, just like the JZ series, but it can only hold around 400 to 500 wheel horsepower. Now, I know that there are people that have pushed past this number, but 400 to 500 has become the accepted normal as the maximum safe area for the 7M-GTE. This amount of power is plenty for a street car, but if you're building a drag car or maybe an insane time attack car, you may need more power. Luckily, there are quite a few aftermarket rods and pistons to choose from when it comes time to push past that aforementioned power limit. The factory C26 turbocharger really can't make more than 14 PSI because of its size and limitations, so many people end up upgrading to a T3, T4 turbo or something like a Garrett GTX 3076R, which is a good balance between power and throttle response. One thing to note is that if you want your modified 7M-GTE to last a decent amount of time, decking the head and block surface is highly recommended, as is upgrading to a multi-layer steel head gasket. Now, this will get rid of any warping that has occurred from the previously mentioned head problems. Combine with some nice ARP head studs and you really won't have to worry about the cylinder head issue ever again. Of course, big power will require an aftermarket bottom end. If you're happy with staying under 500 wheel horsepower, then the stock bottom end should probably do just fine for your 7M-GTE. I want to hear from you guys. Do you think the 7M-GTE is better than the 1JZ or the 2JZ in any way? If you do, let me know down in the comments below, or if you don't, just let me know that I'm an idiot down in the comments below or something like that. Make sure you guys smash the thumbs up button because it really helps out the channel. Get subscribed so you don't miss out on the future videos. Let me know what videos you want to see in the future. I'm aiming to make more of these in 2021, and I'll see you guys in the next one.